Hi, I'm Megan from the Museum of Science. How are you doing?
Hi. Now I am recording, if that's okay with you.
So how is everything going now that you're locked out of the lab?
I would normally be in the laboratory or in the classroom or in my office. Obviously, I'm at home. So what do we do?
As researchers, particularly those that are working in an active lab, we think the research is perpetual. We don't ever want to shut anything down.
As much automation as I've tried to build up in the lab, there's lots of experiments that aren't automated. So those ones are more or less just put on the shelf. There's no going into lab to operate them.
About a month ago, I was supposed to give a presentation that I and my colleagues are working on in a meeting in Spain, Valencia, Spain, in June. Well, that ain't happening.
My job is to organize educational programming for particularly the undergraduate students within the center. They're trying to figure out how to take their classes and do well this semester, given this sudden change. I think that is pretty challenging.
With my team at MIT, we're looking at the next generation of quantum technologies.
We're looking at these like atomic defect centers in diamonds. So these things are extremely tiny. Diffraction limit of light. So we're talking like 500 nanometers is the thing that we're looking at.
Looking at artificial atoms, little inclusions, fluorescent inclusions in diamond, is actually done with robotic microscopes. We fondly call them ROMIs.
Yeah, our room temperature one is ROMI, just for a robotic microscope. And then we also have like a cryogenic one, which is CRAMI.
And so these ROMIs, these robots are actually remote controlled. For experiments like that, we just have to do some maintenance in the lab. And we do that in a way that doesn't have any people intersect. So the robots are still working.
Put a sample in. It takes us, you know, half an hour to load up the diamond sample into the cryo chamber, you know, hit run on the chamber to vacuum and cool down. And then once it's there, it stays there for weeks at a time. And we can just kind of log into the computer and all of the physical things we need to touch on the setup, that can all be controlled remotely.
So it's actually proving to be kind of a fun experiment in some sense of seeing what kind of these automation tools are actually becoming integral and useful for not only some tiny last bits of my thesis work, but for a lot of the newer students to be able to continue getting data flowing out of the lab in times where you can't even enter the lab.
I'm blessed that I don't need a laboratory to do my experiments. I do my experiments on a computer. So all I need is the quietness of a home office and the internet. So in fact, I use supercomputers based in Texas and California, and I access those facilities remotely, do some calculations and writing up a paper with some colleagues at Harvard. So from that point of view, the social distancing really doesn't affect me as much as it does my experimental colleagues. But supercomputers are huge machines that need a lot of power and a lot of maintenance. They're still open, so they're still staffed. Thousands and thousands of researchers throughout the country are using these facilities. I mean, they can do their version of social distancing, but still you need human beings to staff those facilities.
Instead of being an experimentalist right now, those are switching hats and putting on a theory hat. And so it gives us time then to think back on what we're doing, what we're trying to do, take a step back, look at it from a bigger picture.
I've already seen that there's some new ideas that are coming about from people because they're sitting home without constant distractions and so on. And they're actually pretty encouraged that some good things will come out of this.
I already have an experiment going on in my mind, and I have things sort of lined up to do one experiment after the next. The physical lab is shut down, but the mental lab is still going on.
Using a supercomputer is more than just putting information in and getting stuff out. You need time to sit down and ask yourself, well, what are these calculations telling me? Do I believe them? Do these results make sense with what other people have done? Do they predict new behavior phenomena?
I think the research part of my work has to go more towards writing papers, analyzing data.
Writing is extremely important because clear writing forces clear thinking.
I can't complain. I'm not sick. So I think we have to do what we can for people who can get sick.
Some of my colleagues are figuring out ways to support the effort to overcome the virus, whether it's making masks, or I have a colleague that came up with the 3D printing of masks, you know, so people are sewing, people are just sharing their knowledge.
Things like donating PPE, personal protective equipment. So like the clean rooms at MIT have donated basically all the remaining supplies of masks and gloves and booties and anything that they have to local hospitals. And I think seeing that kind of outpouring of people coming together for communities has been really cool to see.
We never thought about this infectious disease modeling. You would like to find the best estimate of what is the underlying ground truth of the spread of the disease, given sparse and imperfect measurements. Well, that modeling becomes very, very hard very quickly. That's actually computationally impossible with today's computers. So if we had computers that can do network problems better, we might be able to, given the data that we do have, understand better how to interpret it, get better estimates. At the same time, that will tell us where to place detectors or whom to test. Hopefully the disease will not drag out so long that quantum computers are going to be truly useful on this very one.
So do look forward to the end of social distancing, because like other enterprises, scientific research really at the end of the day does involve personal interactions. You need to be able to discuss your results with people in person. You need to be able to develop and maintain relationships with other scientists. You need to be able to meet new scientists. And by sitting in a room listening to other scientists and engineers talk about what they're doing, you learn a lot.